Hello there, world. Welcome to the Dragon's Blood post-show. My name is SirActionSlacks, and I'm here with two of Dota's greatest. Hello, we've got ODPixel Owen. Say hello, Dota's greatest caster.
Hello, Dota's greatest caster.
Thank you, Owen. And of course, we got Sheever. Sheever, what is your title these days? What are you calling yourself?
Dota 2 personality and host.
Wow, that's very exciting,
Sheever.
Welcome to the show. All right, guys, we have just seen Dota, Dragon's Blood, the series, the entire thing, and we are here to get into the nitty-gritty of the series and talk about all our hype. We're talking about the lore. We're talking about the in-depth deep dive. If you haven't seen the series yet, do not watch this. Full spoilers. This is the deep dive of the whole thing, guys. So let's go ahead and start off with just initial impressions. I'm very excited to see. I mean, it was so hype getting into it, just knowing that Dota had an anime. But Owen, what did you think about the show in general?
I mean, for me, the thing that I enjoyed the most about it was just how much more of the Dota world it showed compared to what you just think of being there, right? Normally, you're playing this game, you're in a battlefield, you got five heroes against five heroes. You know, it's all good and fun most of the times. but then when you're watching a show like this, you find out about all these characters that you've never heard of. You know, all these sort of these places, all these sort of different interactions, the way the world works and operates, which was fantastic to see. And you know, as a longtime Dota 2 player, something that, you know, as someone that doesn't normally read the lore, doesn't read the little bits of subtext, I didn't know what to expect, but I ended up learning a lot about the world, and it just made me very excited to see more of what can be done already, as I think this season, as a starting point, is a fantastic introduction to sort of saying, hello, you know, there's this whole incredible world to explore and stories to unfold. This is what can be done with it.
Doesn't read the lore. Not cool, bro. Not cool. Sheever, what were you thinking about the show? First impressions overall?
Well, first of all, just touching on what Owen said, I do know some of the lore of Dota 2.
Oh!
But for me, it's all like separate stories. Like every character has their own lore, kind of separate from everybody else. So this was really exciting for me to see that these heroes connected to each other, right? Because that doesn't really happen in any other time. Obviously, you got the little voice lines here and there, but it doesn't really tell you anything. So now we actually see how some of these heroes are connected to each other. So I thought that was really cool. And I was mostly, I was surprised by the high amount of gore and sex in the show as well. I have watched animes before, and I knew this was an adult anime. It was a very adult anime. So yeah, it was refreshing to see. I liked it though.
Yeah, well, let's talk about that a little bit, because I think that's something so unique to the Dota community, right? I mean, you couldn't, video games, so many people think about them as like, you know, this young person's thing, and the Dota community itself is kind of, you know, this game's been out for 18 years. I think there's not a lot of games where you could have super adult content like this and not have it be like, wow, coming completely out of left field. Owen, what'd you think? Was it too mature for you, bro? Did you were you afraid of the emotions?
No. Despite my appearance, no, I was old enough to enjoy all the content involved. I think it's great, and it's just very fitting for the world that Dota 2 is.
Yeah, it's a brutal world out there. Anything could happen.
It was.
A wizard could just walk by and turn you inside out. I mean, that's kind of like what it's established in there. So stakes were pretty high in the anime, I thought, which was pretty cool just because of that. It really grounded it for me. But for me, favorite things about this anime is looking at old characters. So many times in the Dota lore and in the Dota universe, they'll introduce new characters, and that will be some new lore or a new place or a new thing. Happened a lot in the show, but my favorite part, at least, is that they focused on old characters like Invoker and Luna and Mirana, and Dragonite, of course. These guys that we've been playing for so long, but we don't really know anything about. Especially Invoker, just like seeing him get a backstory, seeing him interact with other characters, that for me feels so much better than like some new character doing all that.
I thought that the way that it was sort of introduced to you, this world, I really enjoyed sort of the opening of the series. I mean, the opening and the ending, which I guess is sort of standard for a season. That's normally when the most exciting things happened. And sort of scene wise as well, I think that the ending of the first episode, where we get the whole sort of the real sort of understanding of what's going to be happening with this dragon knight hero Davian at the center of it all, you know, with Slyrak when he's in the cave, and you have this whole big showdown between sort of this possessed Eldworm by Terrorblade and Slyrak himself. And then the whole little twist where he thinks Slyrak's going to take that mercy blow, and then bam, you know, hits out and suddenly Davion's knocked to the ground. I just thought that was a great introduction, and it really sort of sets the opening for what we're going to find out, you know, in regards to why and, you know, who Davian the Dragon Knight really is, you know, the importance of Slyrak and the things to follow. So I really enjoyed that opening to it all. And I felt that the season had a really good sort of cadence where it did come to all these parts where, you know, new heroes were being introduced. And you know, as soon as they were involved in the storyline, you wanted to know where they fitted in and sort of the relevance of them, the way that they connect with other characters, which, you know, slowly that you get unraveled upon you, but in a way that always keeps you thinking and doesn't always cover every single intricacy that you'd imagine would be there between the different characters in the show. So a lot of room for your imagination to maybe work out or try and figure out what's potentially still left unsaid about the stories that are touched upon.
I love that first thing that you're talking about, because it really separates people that knew the Dragonlight lore before going in and then the people that didn't.
What is the original lore? The original lore is Slyrak kills the Dragon
Knight?
Yeah.
So the original lore is that Davion was a Dragon Knight who hunted dragons, and he was the last of his kind. He thought that Slyrak was the last of his big dragons, and then when he finds him, he's just weak and unable to do anything, and then Davion says, you know, I'll put you out of your misery, I'll give you a warrior's death, and then the same thing happens. He, like, slits his throat, okay, and they mix the blood together. But there's always this mystery in Dota: is Davion himself, or is he Slyrak in Davian's body? And it's so fun that the anime plays with that as well, where it's like this struggle of, you know, is this going to be a full takeover? Is it going to kill him, kind of thing? So, yeah, it's very similar. And we'll get into why that's okay that they're different later. But, Sheever, before we get too crazy, I do want to talk about your favorite scenes and what do you think about the anime in general?
The dragon in itself, the animation of it, I thought was cool. The scene that Owen mentioned, obviously he mentions the gore as well and the story of it and the impact of the story. But I really like that scene where he comes out and spreads his wings somewhat, like with the shadow behind him. I really like that. Mm. And then one of the things that I thought very interesting about the show was the scene where Davion is one of the eight on the pillar with all the other dragons there. By the way, Winter Wyvern, probably one of the dragons, which means she's a dragon, not a wyvern. What? I thought that was really exciting because all the dragons that were there were very different from each other. And that's really cool in itself. And I have a lot of questions regarding the story itself. And I thought it was just really cool. I must say though, coming away from the season, I have more questions now than I did before I started watching it, because there is so much still like that you just don't know, right?
Yeah, I feel the same way. It's pretty fun to be able to have these now unique storylines directly from the show and so many things that we need to get answers to. But we'll get into dragons later. I'm going to have to debate with you on Winter Wyvern, my friend. We'll get there. But real quickly, I'll just say my favorite part was definitely the shopkeeper scene. So many references and stuff, and like building on that shopkeeper lore. It's pretty interesting, you know, that whole thing where the shopkeepers are kind of watched over by the gods themselves, and that if you make a pact with a trade, it has to be taken. And there's a ton of Easter eggs in the shopkeeper scene as well, like all these items in the background and stuff. So if you didn't notice that, go take another look. And particularly, go watch when he holds the gem up to Mirana for the first time. There is some pretty cool stuff in there that I noticed. Owen, what'd you think about how it ended up?
I think it was cool to see sort of the extent to how kind of evil, you know, Invoker had been, he'd become. Because we kind of didn't really know how badly he'd react to obviously the loss of his child with Selemene, and you know, to what extent he would go to get revenge. And he probably went the furthest you could get, you know, sort of being in cohorts with a Terrorblade that's taking the soul of Selemene in exchange for him giving the souls of the seven dragons in order to give Terrorblade the ability to kind of create and mold the universe in however evil way he wants to. So you know, that's pretty wild. I guess he's pretty upset that his kid did die, which I guess is understandable.
Sure.
But he was very upset.
So I feel completely different than you guys. I feel like Invoker's not a bad guy at all. I think he's fine.
How's he not a bad guy? He's given the power to Terrorblade.
Well,
he's given him all the souls.
He makes him think he gave the power to Terrorblade, but we'll get into that later. Okay. I think that Terrorblade is, of course, a bad guy. He's a demon. He's the baddest demon of demons.
He's a demon.
He's a demon. I'm not trying to be offensive to demon kind, but typically bad guys. But no, I think he's trying to, like, reshape the world in the universe into his own thing. But, I mean, what makes Invoker a bad guy? He's just getting revenge for someone that has crossed him horribly. Selemene is a bad guy.
We're not sure that she was always kind of as crazy and obsessive with people worshipping her as she comes across in the show, right?
Yeah.
You know, there's obviously a point where she took over from Mene in the Night Silver Woods. Maybe before that, maybe there was a reason why that happened.
Sure.
And maybe that reason is Invoker. You know, he's the one hooking up with her. We have that whole scene where Philomena is, they're talking about the flower, her favorite flower, and how it's a hybrid. It's created from two things at the complete opposite ends of the world, the universe, or, you know, just completely different things. And you know, Invoker, he's not a nice guy. I mean, we're seeing him do some pretty evil stuff at the end. You know, it's his responsibility for all the chaos that ensues.
Anyway, let's get into that deep lore. We've already kind of been talking about it, but let's talk about some specific scenes. Now, Sheever, you brought it up, and I kind of want to cover it in general. The show is, you know, dragon's blood, but it's defense of the ancients. And, where were they? We only actually got to see really one scene with one ancient, in my opinion. So what'd you guys think about that whole scene?
I think that obviously was the dire ancient, and also kind of looked a little bit like the dire ancient in the game itself. So that was a pretty straightforward thing. I think the minions around there, the creeps, are actually the creeps in Dota as well. They looked like zombies, probably were zombies in that case. But that was a very clear dire thing. First of all, don't know why it was in the middle of nowhere in the mountains. second, don't know how Mirana got out of it. We saw a light dragon soar towards her with some kind of voice attached to it that I did not recognize. And I don't know, like, we obviously, it just mentioned Selemene with the eyes, and that it was very similar to that type of devotion that Mirana had towards that shrine.
Yeah, I think that moment that you talked about is probably the biggest mystery from season one. How did Mirana get out of the dire trance? Because it's so fun to see that in real life. In the game of Dota, not a lot of people know this, but when you're playing a character, you're under mind control of one of the ancients. That's why any one of the characters, even an evil guy, could be fighting for Radiant. If you're close to what we call a Dire Stone or Radiant Ore, it has that mind control effect. And it was so cool to see that in the show. See people be transformed into creeps both physically and mentally. But how did Mirana get out of that? That is the question, because it wasn't Selemene. We didn't hear Selemene's voice, and she was begging her to, you know, help. But something else got her out of that. So it's very interesting how it differs from regular Dota lore, too. In regular Dota lore, they've been moving more and more to creeps are like actually people, like villages, you know? In a lot of the comics, the creeps are talking to each other and, like, they have societies, but not in this show. In this show, like, they are straight-up mind-controlled zombies, which is really cool to see. I really enjoyed that. But anyway, it kind of looked like one of Mirana's mounts in the game. She has, like, this dragon-like mount that looks very similar to that as well. So I don't know.
So you're saying it could be... Was it a mount saving her? Is that what you're saying?
I don't know. I do think it's the biggest mystery of season one. We do have to talk about Fynryn and her whole deal. I think that her whole situation and what she is super, super, like, it's going to definitely get developed next season. But what did you guys think about the character? At first, I won't lie to you. When Luna was chopping off heads, I was like, kill her. She's too happy for me. She's too much into the love. But I think she's becoming a compelling character.
I think that the start of the... Like, there's definitely a character arc there, right? Where she is also... I don't know, she just comes across like a stubborn teenager or something like that at the start of the show, where it is like, you know, just get over yourself or something like that. But once she starts traveling together with the group, I think she is... that's a very strong character arc for her, and I do like where she ended up to where she is now, following after... Dragon Knight, following after Davion, because, you know, she feels some sort of responsibility, and she also then knows that she doesn't blindly follow anyone anymore, because of the leader of her elves said, you know, we have to taste of war, I want to drink it by the bucket load or something like that, taste of blood. And I think that she is turning into an independent thinker, which I really like. She is not blindly following Mene or Selemene, she is now just doing what she thinks is right.
Right.
Yeah, for me, at a point when watching, I did feel that there was visual similarities between her and Philomena, to the point where I'm like, is somehow sort of the power that was obviously within Philomena being the child of Selemene and Invoker, is that same power in her? There was references to people, people were asking Selemene or talking about Selemene, saying how many other Philomenas have there been? You know, I don't think Selemene's just had one child with Invoker. I mean, I think she's had others. I don't know if they were also with Invoker or if they were with other people. And they're obviously, you know, maybe their descendants or they themselves have ended up in these elf villages, and or maybe the reincarnation of the souls for these things. You know, there's some sort of connection. There's got to be a huge reason why she has these powers. And where do we know these powers come from? They either come from the dragons or they come from the goddesses, right? There's got to be a connection with one of the two. The only person we sort of see flashing all over the place is like Caden, but that's because of all the stuff that he's done with all the dragons that he's killed. So... I can't really work out which side it's coming from, but I feel it's got to be one of the two. It's something to do with the goddesses and the gods, or it's something to do with the dragons.
Some people might want some clarification about how dragons work and all that stuff. So the short and sweet version, as I run you through, and let me know if you guys think I have the right interpretation, is that there are dragons, 8 different kinds. Each represent a different element, and the Eldworms are the oldest of those dragons, and they are pretty much literally that element. The one that we saw die in Barrowhaven, the first one that Terrorblade took over, I think he was like an earth dragon, and then Slyrak is the fire dragon, and there's a bunch of different kinds. And they all sleep, the Eldworms, and they go into this like hive mind consciousness where they could talk to each other, and eventually they'll die. But that soul will reincarnate into another dragon who rises up and becomes an Eldworm after some time. So that's like how dragons work, right? Does that sound right?
Yeah, I have a question.
You
go first, Owen. All right.
Well, you said 8 elements, but I'm pretty sure when Invoker represents it, he says it's 4 elements and 4 fundamentals.
Yeah. Right? So I'm using shorthand terms. So yes.
Sure. So
things,
so it's
like
8
chaos.
Things, but there is a split. Yeah. There's 4 things and 4
right.
things.
Chaos.
Which was
light.
Also quite interesting because 4. Yeah. Because 4 of them, it showed like the Quaswex Resort of the Invoker plus a green orb. So you know, there's another orb in there at the you know, sort of the fundamentals. I think that was that you know, builds everything.
The whole dragon scene was super interesting to see, like how they communicated. You had like the big boy leader dragon who seemed like he was more than just electricity. He seemed like, you know, the molecules attachment, like, you know, that kind of like energy of the universe guy. And then we have to argue about the cold dragon Sheever. I don't think that was Winter Wyvern. I don't think so.
She sounded just like him.
She's not similar, but she's a wyvern. She's not allowed to be in the dragon circle. I won't believe it.
I know, but the similarities were so there.
It's true.
Like, it is, like, it's hard to think otherwise, right?
Yes.
Because it looked so much alike, and the voice was so similar.
All right, well, we've been here for quite some time, so I guess it's time for us to wrap up and talk about just kind of general, the ending. that incredible ending of where it went and where we think that the show is going to go, since we've been talking so much about how excited we are for the future. So, Owen, what did you think about the end? Were you surprised that everything came to a head so fast in this series, or just general thoughts?
Honestly, when they open the box and it turns out, you know, it's not sort of the happy ending that Invoker promised, with just the Lotuses being returned because peace had been declared, that was sort of surprised me. I wasn't prepared for that. I thought, okay, that's going to go normally. And then it, you know, it all kicks off with this, oh, all right, this is the real revenge that Invoker's going after. Great sort of clash, of course, between Terrorblade and Selemene. You know, Terrorblade's just sort of coming out of this poor old lady's back. You know, it's just there worshipping away, and then suddenly, oh, out he comes and starts to go to town on Selemene in this crazy battle between the two of them. Yeah, it was all pretty wild. And then the last line, you know, you're saying Invoker's a good guy. I don't think good guys have lines like that, where he's sort of standing over Selemene saying, "Do you love me?" That's not a good guy trope. That guy, you know, he's in it for the evil of the revenge. You know, he's going in. You know, he's holding nothing back.
Yeah, very interesting. I thought it was a very cool ending, just bringing all this stuff together. I was just like Owen. I thought the show was going to end on this happy note. It's like, hey, they're back, and now we'll all go our separate ways. But no, things went to hell. And I thought that the turn for Kaidan and the Dragonites, that was my favorite part, too. It's just like, we got our boy, let's get out of here. I mean, yeah. It's pretty sweet.
I'm here for the boy.
Yeah, a lot of elf dying, which is a pretty big highlight for me. The elves disgust me, so I'm very happy to see many of them be slaughtered on their way out. But yeah, so with that, the reactions to the ending, reactions to the show, the deep dive of the lore, I guess I'd like to end the show here today for our wrap-up of what do you hope to see next?
I hope they're going to expand more on the Radiant and Dire, because we... Like it kind of was like the one escapade that Mirana went into the Dire thing, and that was kind of the only thing we saw. And we did hear some talk about that, obviously, at the start of episode one, so I hope we learn more about that. I hope we learn more about the dragon that saved Mirana that time as well, and whether Solyrak can be reasoned with, because we don't really know that yet. And I kind of like to have the friendly relationship between man and dragon. Yeah, I do hope that they are going to continue traveling together, and that the storylines don't get too detached from each other, because I think that there's definitely a risk of that.
Oh. Sure. I think there's definitely going to still be continued connections. I mean, and I hope there is. Now, I hope we see more of Davion and Mirana together. You know, that's obviously been fleshed out, this romance between them. You know, we want to see what happens in sort of their future. I'm really interested about the backstories of Marcy and Fynryn. You know, I want to know why they have the abilities that they have, you know, this incredible strength of Marcy, and why she's a mute, and how she came to be with Mirana, and, you know, to be sort of this character that's just consistently with her throughout everything. And yeah, Fynryn, where it came from, you know, how she herself maybe started to have the worship that she did for Mayna. You know, is it just because she's just like the other elves? We see her sort of passing on the story to a group of children. You know, maybe one of the reasons that her group is so in love with this old goddess is because of the message that she brings and shares with them. You know, where does she get that from initially? So very excited to see, hopefully, them do something with those characters. And likewise with Sheev, the connection between dragons and humans, as we know, there's obviously been this age-old clash between the two of them. You know, there's not really a lot of getting on with one another. But the Slyrak-Davion connection has obviously started to change that to the point that we saw at the very end. You know, Kaidan no longer just blindly killing him because Slyrak's inside him, looking to work through that. I mean, there's so much. It's as exactly as Sheev said, you know, this last episode just opens up to what is going to come. You know, it whets your appetite massively for more from these characters, which I didn't necessarily expect going into the season. I thought, all right, I'm going to watch something about Dragon Knight. That's going to be nice. Then I'm going to want to see something about different heroes. And whilst I'm sure, you know, I do hope that they introduce other characters along the storyline, along the adventure, I still have so much that I want to find out about the characters that we've been shown.
Yeah, I agree. With all those points, I think that the Ancients, I definitely want to see more of them, but don't forget that that's the end of the story. Our game in Dota 2 is the defense of the Ancients. That's the culminant battle. So I think it's going to take a long time.
We've got a few seasons for that.
Right. That's like the long thread. Yeah. I want more Dota heroes. Okay, that was my favorite part of the whole show, is saying, holy shit, Invoker's in this? Like, that's great. So more heroes, more locations. Give me more of just the show in general. I had a great time. So, guys, thank you so much. Dota, Dragon's Blood, great show. And it was a pleasure watching it. So thank you, of course, to Netflix, Studio Mir, and to Valve themselves for letting something like this happen. Well done there. We hope to see a lot more. And if we do see a lot more, it's on you, viewers. Go out there and watch the show. Show it to your friends. Get us more seasons. We need answers to these questions, right? But, yeah, thank you so much for your time. And, we'll see you around. My name is SirActionSlacks. This is ODPixel. And this is Sheever. And we'll see you in the world of Dota. Bye-bye.